Hello, and welcome back to Chagpar MD. I'm Dr. Anise Chagpar. In case you missed it, last time we did a video with my very good friend, Dr. Lajos Pusztai, who is a professor of medicine here at Yale, along with the director of the Breast Cancer Translational Research Group, co-director of Cancer Genetics, Genomics, and Epigenetics at Yale Cancer Center, and the Breast Cancer Research Group lead for SWOG, Southwest Oncology Group. Suffice it to say, he knows a lot about breast cancer medical oncology. And last time we talked a lot about advances in early breast cancer management. I'll leave you a link for that video here. This week, we're gonna dig more into metastatic breast cancer. So what do you say? Let's get started. So Lajos, in the metastatic setting, what do you see have been the key advances that have been made in terms of treatment? Many people who are diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer, I mean, any metastatic, any kind of cancer, often look at this like a death sentence. The cancer is spread outside of the breast and lymph nodes. Oftentimes, this is not something that surgeons are chomping at the bit to take out. And so patients may be left with a sense of a lack of hope and despair. But you have a different philosophy.
Yeah, so maybe it's helpful to think about metastatic disease again in two different sort of forms. There is metastatic disease that represents a recurrence after all these wonderful therapies that I just described. So recurrence in that context obviously implies that this is a cancer cell, or it's a cancer that survived all these treatments. And indeed, in that context, in the recurrent metastatic disease, cure remains elusive. But there are many diseases which are like that. So diabetes is incurable. Heart disease is incurable. Yet people live many years with it. And I think that's sort of one of the goals that we are getting closer in terms of metastatic breast cancer as well, that people simply live with it for many, many years. But it's true, and it's unfortunate, that ultimately most patients die from their breast cancer. But we want them to live many, many years and continue their productive life as long as it's possible. There is another group of metastatic breast cancers which are increasingly higher proportion of the metastatic population, not because they are getting more and more of these, but because the recurrences are getting rarer and rarer after the initial therapy. So this other group we call de novo, or newly diagnosed de novo stage 4 disease, when someone presents with metastatic disease from the get-go. And I think in that population, with a clever strategy, we could actually cure some patients the same way as we can cure locally advanced disease. So when you come in with the 5-centimeter breast cancer, 3 or 4 positive nodes, then that's a local advanced disease. Yet the majority of these patients are still cured. So this is, for example, the clinical trial that I refer to in the adjuvant context, right, with the CDK4/6 inhibitors. So the actual risk of recurrence was about 18% at 3 years. So 18, right? So actually 12. So 88% had no recurrence, despite of being locally advanced at the 2 or 3 year follow-up. So I think the de novo stage 4 metastatic patients, a subset of them might be able to be cured with a very similar aggressive approach that we apply to the adjuvant setting. That implies removing the known cancer sites, radiating what we can radiate, and giving the systemic therapies. But that's more of a work in progress. So there are clinical trials that suggest that this strategy works in general across cancers. There's good data in prostate cancer. And we hope to generate the same data to convince the larger sort of community that this is indeed the valid strategy for this de novo stage 4 population with oligometastatic, or disease that can really be treated at the local sites as well as systemically. So that's about the strategies. But in terms of the more sort of traditional, conventional way to approach metastatic disease, that describes primarily patients who had an initial treatment and then they recur, the advances there really come from new drugs. And in the ER-positive space, the CDK4/6 inhibitors were these drugs which have shown to improve survival, and they came into the market and the clinic about maybe 10 years ago. And more recently, a new class of drugs came into the clinic, and these are PI3 kinase inhibitors. And that's for patients who have a particular molecular abnormality, a PI3 kinase mutation. So that's an important new therapeutic sort of addition to ER, to treat ER positive metastatic disease. In the triple negative group, we also have a remarkably effective new drug that was just approved by the FDA literally again a few months ago, and that's called sacituzumab govetican. It's again an antibody drug conjugate, and it showed very high objective response rates and improved survival in patients with heavily pretreated metastatic triple negative disease. And there are a number of other really interesting novel drugs that are being tested in the context. So I would like to point this out, that all new drugs are being tested first in the metastatic population. And participating in clinical trials is a good idea because it really provides an opportunity for any particular patient who participates in the study to receive potentially the therapies of the future today. So many of these drugs that we test in the clinic won't ultimately be better than existing drugs or won't make it to the market, but some do. And if you were in that population, then you actually got a drug that helped you and you got it before it became widely available. The standard of care options are always available, and a patient can always default back to that. So, so new drugs are also emerging in the HER2 positive space. And again, there is a new sort of antibody drug conjugate, which is like the first cousin of the T-DM1 or the Herceptin plus chemotherapy combination. So there is a newer version of this sort of antibody drug conjugate therapy, and that's called trastuzumab deruxtecan. So unfortunately, each of these new drugs get a more complicated name that's getting even difficult to pronounce or remember, but they do represent improvements beyond the name. So this drug is marketed under the trade name Enhertu, and this again has been shown to be remarkably effective in patients who have progressed on all of the previous treatments that we were discussing. Yeah, so there are new drugs coming to the clinic, and another important sort of advance again very recently was in the treatment of brain metastasis for HER2 positive disease, and that's a trial that combined three drugs. And including Herceptin and capecitabine, which are, Herceptin is a HER2 targeted antibody, capecitabine is a chemotherapy drug, but adding a third drug, a kinase inhibitor, a HER2 kinase inhibitor, tucatinib, to this doublet, improved the survival of the patients, and most importantly, actually controlled brain metastasis with really high efficacy. And that's a new thing. That's actually, there have been a paucity or a lack of effective drugs that would actually treat brain metastasis. So now we have this triplet, the tucatinib, Herceptin, capecitabine, that has shown actually activity in the brain.
Yeah, that's so important because many patients who have brain metastases often have heard about this blood-brain barrier and how, you know, cancers can hide out in the brain and it's harder for chemotherapies to get there. I want to go back to one of the comments that you made earlier about the PI3 kinase inhibitors, and we talked a little bit about this being a biomarker. So it sounds like these PI3 kinase inhibitors are being used in the metastatic setting, but this really hasn't found its way into the adjuvant setting yet. Do you think that it will?
Of course. I mean, so all the drugs that show their efficacy in the metastatic setting tend to be tested and brought to the early stage setting with the hope that not only prolongs patients' lives, but actually improves the cure rates. In what shape or form the PI3 kinase inhibitors will actually be tested in the clinic is yet to be figured out. So currently there are no adjuvant trials with this class of drugs, but I'm certain I have some ideas how to bring this into the clinic. But another important point to make is that I hope that I convey this, that we really made important advances and we cured more and more patients from breast cancer, but by curing more and more, we really add up more and more drugs. And some of these regimens now really, like in the HER2 positive space, can extend out for 2 years, including 7 or 8 drugs that someone would need to take over 2 years. So another important sort of research direction is to try to de-escalate care, recognizing that every addition really improves the outcome a little bit. And that's only a little bit, because a lot of the patients were already cured by the previous sort of strategies or other components of their regimen. So there's a lot of emphasis of trying to sort of de-escalate care and find the patients who don't need improvements basically in medicine anymore, because the existing drugs cure them. In fact, the drugs that existed 10 years ago could have cured them. So that's called de-escalation strategy. And I think this de-escalation strategy have to be part of the PI3 kinase sort of exploration as well. So it probably will need to focus on a group that is remains high risk despite all the current therapies. Because just adding it on for another 2 years after you did all the things, it'll be very expensive. It's gonna require a very large study because very few people will benefit since we do so well already. And of course, it will bring a lot of toxicity for a lot of people who don't need it.
Yeah.
So I ought to add, though, that while I'm all very enthusiastic about these new drugs, of course, they all come with their own side effects.
Yeah, and I think that that's the thing, is that for so many patients with metastatic disease, there is this sense of almost desperation of trying to find something that will prolong their life, especially when you've just been handed this diagnosis that you see as a death sentence. So on the one hand, there's so much hope about the advances that have been made and the possibilities of making metastatic breast cancer more like a chronic disease than something that is really a death sentence. But on the other hand, yeah, there's also all of the toxicity that you mentioned in terms of not only the physical side effects, but the financial toxicity and so on that goes with it.
Yeah, I mean, I really try to really steer away from this idea that you describe metastatic disease as a death sentence. I mean, life is a death sentence, right? So there are many incurable diseases that ultimately shorten patients' lives. So I think it's not a helpful way to think about this.
Right.
So this is a disease that unfortunately a person has or developed, and that's not their own fault. And it's just like any other disease. We actually have good treatments for it, and we will keep you going as long as it is possible.
Yeah,
and that's no different from many other things which carry far less fear, like even obesity, or that is of course not a disease, but it shortens people's lives. And we know this from studies, from population, and there is no the same degree of fear attached to it, or diabetes, or high blood pressure, or hypercholesterolemia, or heart disease. So people take medications for this so that they live longer and avoid the side effects of all these diseases. It's the same idea with metastatic disease. So you want to take medications to avoid the side effect of the cancer itself. And we have better and better therapies, and people live longer and longer.
Yeah, it's so nice to hear that there really is hope, because you're quite right. I mean, while that concept of a death sentence is not helpful, it is something that many patients have because they are fearful of not only of cancer, but especially of metastatic cancer. And I think that the true benefit is all of the research that's going on that's really pushing the frontiers to find better and better therapies that will keep patients alive longer and with a better quality of life. And so I think our final message is really to talk to your oncologist about the trials that you're eligible for. Well, that was fabulous. I hope all of you gained as much out of it as I did, particularly in understanding that there is hope for metastatic breast cancer. And I hope that you will like, share, and subscribe. Please do share this with a friend that you think could use the information. And if there's any other topics that you'd like covered, please let us know that as well. I'm here to try to create a community really dedicated to evidence-based health and wellness, and your participation helps us to do that. Until next week, this is Dr. Anise Chagpar wishing you all a safe and healthy week.